In the US, you'll find water towers located every couple of miles, and this is true in most countries around the world. But oftentimes, these buildings were built several decades ago, and with the rapidly developing world around us, are these structures even used? And if so, why do we still need them? Well, if your city has a water tank, chances are high that your city still depends on it for water. The reason we have water tanks is because they are essential in supplying the city with flowing water. By rising water high above a city, we are able to pressurize the water with the help of gravity. The gravitational force allows for all buildings that are shorter than the water tower to receive flowing water. This ingenious system has actually been used for several centuries and dates back to ancient times. But this modern use of water towers didn't come to be till the mid-1800s, mainly because we didn't have the infrastructure to support it. Given that over a million gallons of water is stored in water towers in many cases, it wasn't until the rise of steam pumping that we came up with pipes that could handle the extreme pressure. This new development gave rise to water towers across the world, many of which are still working to this day. Some of the most famous water towers that still exist today are the Louisville Water Tower and Chicago Water Tower. A few historic water towers have actually been turned into penthouses. Fun fact, many of these water towers were built from wood and still are. And to this day, no sealant is used when constructing these water towers. As a result, when they are first filled, they actually leak through the gaps between the wood pieces. However, as water saturates the wood pieces and the wood expands, it creates an impermeable boundary for the water. Anyways, when these water towers were first in service, how did cities actually get water up that high? Well, in New York, windmills were used to pump up water from hand-dug wells. Today, water is generally extracted from a river, well, or local lake. This water is then sent to a water treatment plant to remove sediment and bacteria. This water is then pumped to water tower feeder pipes, which then pump up water to the top of the tower. The amount of water that is pumped into a water tower is generally the amount of water a region uses in one day. Every region will have a peak time where the pump will not be able to keep up with the demand. This is often in the morning when many people are taking showers, brushing their teeth, cooking, and so on. Conversely, at night, when the water use is practically zero as most people are sleeping, the pump refills the tower for the day. So that's how the modern water tower came to be and the basics of how they work. But why do we still use these things? Is there not a more efficient way to supply pressurized water than pumping water up hundreds of feet? Well, in many countries, instead of pumping water up into towers for an entire region, individual buildings will have their own water tank on the roof. This puts more responsibility on the owner as they have to constantly ensure the water tanks are full and refill them as they drop. This is also true for many commercial buildings and all skyscrapers in the US. Huge apartment complexes would draw out so much water from a municipal supply that they are expected to build their own water supply. Similarly, skyscrapers will not only draw out a significant portion of municipal water supply, but they are also simply too tall for a municipal tower to suffice. Oftentimes, you can find the water tanks at the roof of such buildings in plain sight, but in some cases, they're hidden within the top couple of floors in a building. But whether a large singular tower for an entire region or smaller tanks for each building, the system is the same, using gravity to supply water. While this system works quite efficiently, it does require millions of dollars to build and, more importantly, constant maintenance in order to ensure that the water tower is not only clean, but in good condition. The extreme pressure created by these colossal structures also introduces the risk of expensive line breaks. The most basic solution would be to simply pump water from a water pumping facility to meet a region's demand. In the past, this clearly wasn't possible as pumps simply could not meet that much demand or vary based on demand, but they are today. One such invention is a cycle stop valve. This valve varies the pump output to exactly match the demand, and many cities have already started utilizing these. There aren't any cities as of now that completely rely on these for water. However, many cities that are growing past their water supply from the water towers are resorting to building water pumping stations instead of whole new towers. These stations simply boost water supply by pumping water into water lines during peak demand to alleviate pressure from water towers. Of course, water towers are still being constructed, but the reliance on them is slowly decreasing as our technology improves. In the end, water towers have been used for many centuries and are still used today due to their simplicity and, till recently, unbeatable efficiency. However, the enormous cost of building and maintaining them, along with improvements in technology, have led to many alternatives springing up, like water pumping stations. Despite this, most of the world still gets our water from municipal water towers or water tanks on the roof. But moving forward, we may very well see more and more water towers being abandoned as even more efficient systems take their place. If you guys thought this video explained why we still use water towers well, then make sure to drop a like and consider subscribing if you'd like to see more questions just like this one logically answered. But until then, I'm Hari, and I'll see you guys on the next one.